Grace, and I'm a Blue Coat Scientist from Science North. For today's demonstration, we're going to be looking into growth and changes in plants. And specifically focusing on trees and learning about just how they reproduce. Now for the activity at the end of the video, you're going to need a couple things. First, you're going to need 3 pine cones of the same kind. You can find these in your backyard, around your neighborhood, but please stick to ones you find on the ground. We don't need to be taking them off of trees. You'll also need 3 clear containers that your pine cones can fit in, as well as some cold and warm water. Also, a timer if you have one. Now, before we hop into our demonstration and our activity, I want to make sure we have a good background knowledge on trees. Now, first, is a tree alive? Is it a living thing? Well, we know that living things, they grow, they move, they need food and water for energy, they breathe, and lastly, they reproduce. So yes, a tree is alive, a tree is a living thing, but it does all of these things much different than us as humans, as well as other animals do, right? Yes. So today we're going to be focusing on just one of these. We're going to be focusing on reproduction and how trees reproduce. Now, trees start their lives in one way, as a seed, like all other plants. Now here, I have an eastern white pine seed here. So this is how a tree starts its life. It is dropped by its parent tree onto the ground, and then it's dispersed all over the place. It can be moved around by wind, by water, by animals, and even by humans. Did you know that you're often carrying around seeds and dispersing them into new habitats all the time, and you probably don't even know it, which is pretty cool. Now, if the seed finds a habitat with optimal growing conditions, it'll begin to sprout. But most seeds will remain dormant over the winter and not sprout until the spring or the summer, when conditions are more optimal. So the seeds are able to sense temperature, light, and moisture levels to know when it's the best time for it to sprout. And once it sprouts, it'll start looking a little like this. So the stem will start reaching up towards the sun to capture light to produce energy to keep growing, as well as it'll start sending some roots down into the soil to soak up water as well as provide stability for the plant. Now, if the sprout receives enough water, sun, and nutrients, it'll keep growing into a seedling, growing more and more leaves and growing bigger and bigger into an adult tree. Now, adult trees can grow to over 300 years old, and in Canada, we have some absolutely amazing tree species. The largest ones are actually found on our west coast in British Columbia. One of these is the western red cedar, Thuja plicata. It can grow to be over 2,000 years old. And if we wanted to measure just how big it is, if we wanted to wrap a rope around the entire circumference, we would need a rope larger than the average school bus to wrap around. Pretty wild. Now, the oldest one, around 2,000 years old, contains enough wood to build 450 telephone poles. Pretty crazy. I know you're probably trying to imagine just how big this tree is that I'm describing. Now, if you look at this picture here, this isn't the biggest western red cedar, but this is a pretty big, pretty old western red cedar in British Columbia. Now, if you look really close, you can see there's someone standing right beside the tree here. Now, this is one of my friends, and he is actually taller than I am. He's about the size of the average male. Now, beside the tree here, looks pretty small. This shows you just the scale of how big these trees can get if they have really good growing conditions. Adult trees complete the life cycle by producing seeds of their own. Now, a cool fact with this is that most trees actually have both male and female cones. And the cones we classically think of as a pine cone are actually the female cones. So this here is a female eastern white pine cone, and this is what contains the seeds. But the seeds need to be fertilized, and that's where the male cones come in. Male cones are pollen cones, and they release pollen carried by the wind to be dispersed, and when they end up in the female seed cone, you have a fertilized seed, which is the seed to complete this life cycle and grow into new trees. Now that we've explored the life cycle of trees and seen just how big they can get, we're going to focus more on how trees spread their seeds. But we're going to focus on coniferous species today. Now, a coniferous tree is generally evergreen trees that have needle-like or scale-like leaves. So if we think of the pine trees, the cedar trees, the fir trees, and the spruce trees outside, they have needles. Now this here is the branch of a balsam fir. It has needle-like leaves. And yes, needles are leaves. They do capture sunlight to produce energy through photosynthesis. Now these leaves look much different than the leaves that we would see on, say, a maple or an oak tree. Those are broadleaf leaves. Now there's pros and cons to having the needles or the broadleaf leaves. For example, in the needles. In the winter, generally, most trees are able to keep the needles on all year round to produce energy all year round. Except for the tamarack species, of course, that is the one exception. But with the broadleaf species of trees, like the maple, they have much bigger surface area on their leaf, and they're able to capture so much more sunlight, therefore producing more energy through photosynthesis. But in the fall, they have to shed their leaves and grow new ones in the spring, and this process requires a lot of energy. Conifers also use cones to protect their seeds. Now, cones come in all different shapes and sizes. Here in Ontario, we have so many different varieties of cones, from the eastern white pine, white spruce, even red spruce, and they come as small as the hemlock cone or the eastern white cedar cone. Now, different coniferous trees have different cones with different characteristics to maximize the chance that the seed will have to survive. Now, a really cool example of this is with one of my favorite trees, the jack pine, Pinus banksiana. Now, if we look at their cone, this here is a jack pine cone, they look a little different than, say, the eastern white pine cone that we looked at before. If we look at the scales, they're closed very tightly. No matter how hard I try to open it, I cannot break this cone. It is one of the toughest cones out there. And it has a special adaptation called a serotonous cone, which means there's a natural resin holding together all of the scales, making it so the seeds can't come out. But the seeds need to come out in order to plant new seeds. So how could we open it? It's actually with heat. The resin needs to melt in order to open. It needs to reach 50 degrees Celsius to be exact in order to melt. Now, in what situation would a pine cone get that hot in order to melt and release its seeds? Let's say a fire, like a forest fire? I think so. Now, this is going to be our demonstration today, but I need to put on my fire gear and step outside. So I'll see you in a second. So now we've seen how extreme temperatures affects the jack pine cone. So this is the pine cone that I lit on fire just a few minutes ago outside, and we can see how just how leaving it for a few minutes, it opened up even more. Now if I shake this out onto my hand, we should be able to find some seeds. I got a couple there. This here is the jack pine seed. So you can see this seed on the end with a big wing attached to it, and this helps it catch the wind and get dispersed all over the place. Pretty cool, eh? Now, for our activity, this is an activity that you can try at home. I want to see how other pine cones react to different temperatures, cold and hot climates. Now, for the activity, I'm going to use some eastern white pine cones, but if you can find other kinds of cones, you can try those out too. Just make sure that you have three from the same type of tree. So I have three eastern white pine cones here. Now, before we actually start the activity, we need to make some notes on what the cone looks like before so that we can compare to the after. So in your notebook, write down maybe how long it is, how wide it is, and look really close how open or closed each of the openings look. So after you've done this, we'll get the rest of our materials ready. You'll need 3 clear jars. So here, I've labeled this one cold. I just use a tape and marker, but you can use whatever you'd like to label it cold. Our second container, we're going to label warm. Now, we don't want this to be too hot. We just want it warm. We don't want to burn ourselves. And the third one, this we're actually not going to do anything with it. I haven't put any tape on it because this is going to be our control test. So this will help us compare to the cold and hot test that we do. Now, once we have them labeled, I've already filled up my warm water jar with nice warm water. And in my cold water jar, I will fill it up with nice cold water. As cold as my tap will go. Perfect. Now we need to make sure we leave enough room to put our cones inside. Now, once you have those ready, if you have a timer, you can start your timer and put your cones in all at the same time. But it's really important to keep a close eye on the glasses. See what changes you notice with the cones. Do they start opening? Do they start closing? Do they look bigger, smaller? What happens? Changing color? Whatever you notice, write down in your notebook and see if you can find any cool results with this test. What did you notice happen to your cones? And why do you think this happened? You can answer all these questions in your handout. And with that, that brings me to the end of my video. Thank you so much for joining me for Science at Home. I had a great time teaching you about the exciting lives of coniferous trees. Have a great day.